Thank you so much. So thank you, Kanchanaji and Sateji. Today, I mean, last time we had spoken about Buddhism and also how the rediscovery of Indian history was done with the help of certain things. And today we are going to speak on Akbar and the discovery of this one, Ibadat Khana, and the Christian chapel at Fatehpur Sikri. We all know that Akbar the Great, he instituted a small structure at Fatehpur Sikri, where he had invited people from all the religions because he wanted to learn more about different religions, Hindus, Muslims, Christians, Jains, Jews, and also Parsis. They came to the hall of inter-religious discussions. They started speaking about the relative merit of their own religion. Akbar listened to them very carefully, closely questioned them, and ultimately he evolved a new religion known as Deen-e-Ilahi, which is rightfully considered as the nursery of Indian secularism. But the biggest question was, where is this Ibadat Khana? That is, where was this Ibadat Khana, or where was it formed, which is the particular building structure? Most of the historians, they had identified various standing monuments of Fatehpur Sikri as Ibadat Khana, and they were all standing at that time. But there was one historian, his name is Sayyid Ahmad Mararavi. He said that it is not among the standing monuments of Fatehpur Sikri. Long back it had fallen down, and now it is in the shape and form of a small mound on which many trees were also growing up. So he was an Urdu scholar. People did not take him very seriously. And he was not having additional proof also in support of his own version. Then came two other scholars. One was Professor Rizvi and Dr. Flynn. They also said the particular buildings, that structure, that mound, which was pointed out by Sayyid Ahmad Mararavi, is the real place of Ibadat Khana. But again, they too had no proof in support of it. So when I reached Fatehpur Sikri in the year 1978-79, along with Archaeological Survey of India team also, and I was from Aligarh Muslim University, under Professor R.C. Gore of Aligarh Muslim University, we reached the site, explored the entire area of Fatehpur Sikri, and ultimately we also came to the opinion that the more possibility of the site being the place of Ibadat Khana is to this particular mound. So this mound was between the Jama Masjid of Fatehpur Sikri and Jodhabai's Mahal. And then we started excavating that place. When we excavated the place, we got three terraces. 1, 2, 3. And then in order to prove that this was the real Ibadat Khana at that time, there was no photography at that time during the time of Akbar. But fortunately, Akbar, most of the important events of his lifetime, he had got it painted. This is known as Akbarnama painting. One is the Akbarnama main book is there. It is in two volumes. But then you have the Akbarnama painting also. These paintings were, of course, with Akbar initially. Then it was passed on to Jahangir, then to Shah Jahan, then to Aurangzeb. Then during the later with this Mughal period in 1739, The entire thing was looted by Nader Shah from Delhi, and it was taken to his own Persia. And from there, it went into various libraries. One group of this Akbarnama painting, it is in Victoria Albert Museum. Another group is in British Museum. And another smaller group is in some other libraries also. So one of that painting was the discussion that was going on at Ibadat Khana with Akbar and also the Christian fathers who had come from Italy and Spain. Akbar had invited Christian fathers from Italy and Spain. Actually, they had come to Goa. In Goa, there was a very big institution known as St. Paul. They were the teachers of the St. Paul. And from there, Akbar invited them. So both of them went. Father Rodolfo Acquaviva, he was an Italian, and Father Montserrat, he was a Spanish man. They went to Akbar. They had a lot of discussion about the relative merit of Christianity. They were hopeful that Akbar would be, because Akbar was very close to them. So they were very hopeful that Akbar could be converted into Christianity. Because in the initial stage of the discussions, Akbar was always favoring this group, that is the Christian group, against the Muslim group. So they thought that Akbar is on the verge of conversion into Christianity. Naturally, the whole Muslims, they went against Akbar. There were certain revolts also in various parts of the country. Not only the Muslims, even the Rajput ladies in the harem of Akbar, because Akbar had married a number of Hindu princes from various places. From, of course, from Jaipur family, he had married Rajput families. And also he had married from Bikaner and Jaisalmer also. So many Rajput ladies were there. They were also against these fathers because in the eventuality of Akbar's conversion into Christianity, Akbar is then supposed to keep up only the senior most wife and he will have to divorce all the other wives. So that was also, these Rajput ladies were also against them. Then Akbar was having discussions. But they were very strong-headed people. The Jesuit fathers, they were very strong-headed people because they said that only their religion is the right religion. And that was exactly the argument of the earlier Muslim groups also. Akbar, of course, in the earlier stage, he was a very devout Muslim. And he thought that only Islam is the right religion. And then this Ibadat Khana, discussions at Ibadat Khana was started in order to know more about Islamic religion. But when this Ibadat Khana was started only for the Muslims initially, these Muslim scholars who had come to Ibadat Khana, they started fighting among themselves on every issue. So for the first time, Akbar had a doubt in his mind. They say that I'll be starting the PPT after this one, after 5 minutes more. Okay, yeah. So initially, when he saw that Muslims are fighting, Muslims are saying that, only Islam is the right religion, only Muslim will go to paradise. No other follower of any other religion will not go to paradise. And why are they fighting among themselves on small issues of religion? And the fight was, always, very strong fight between the among the Muslim groups. So that jolted him out of faith in Islam. And that is why he opened this Ibadat Khana for the followers of all the religion. And because of this thing, now he became, the same kind of argument is being followed by the Christian fathers also. And as far as the Hindu religions are, Hinduism, Hinduism, Jainism, and Parsi, they were not like that. They spoke about the relative merit of their own religion, but at the same time, they did not speak any other thing about the conversion of that man into this thing. So Akbar liked them, and Akbar also started doing this Surya Sahasranama. And he was doing various other things also. He was started worshipping like that of a Hindu. Sometimes he would be coming to Diwan-e-Aam, marking his forehead like that of a Hindu. And sometimes, you know, he'll be starting worshipping like that of a Jain also. And he started doing this Surya Sahasranama also. So ultimately, these fathers, they could not convert Akbar. They went back to Goa. So now, how Akbar started, because Akbar, you know, he was having a huge empire like this, a very big empire. So initially, when he started, he was having only a small portion of Punjab, because he was born as a refugee. He had nothing of his own. Then he had only a small portion of Punjab. Then he started conquering the entire India from Delhi, because, you know, in the initial stage itself, in the year 1556, in the second battle of Panipat, he conquered Delhi, Agra, and other things. And then almost the entire northern India, also the present day Bangladesh, Pakistan, and Afghanistan. It was such a huge empire he had. And nobody else at that time had such a very big empire except Philip II of Spain. So now, after having conquered all these things, he wanted to bring both Hindus and Muslims into one single harmonious whole. So what should we do for that one, for bringing Muslims and Hindus? So Muslims should learn about Hinduism, about Hindu mythology, about Mahabharata, about Ramayana, and all these mythologies. And at the same time, Hindus also should learn about Islamic mythology and Islamic history also. So for that, he got translated most of the Hindu mythologies. I mean, he started translating into Persian and along with the paintings. So here we can see, we know the history of this one. I mean, this is the whole thing, is that the fight between Asuras and Devas, it is going on. And the churning of the ocean is this particular portrayal. And in that we can see, on the one side we have the Devas. Here one can easily identify, this is Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva is there along with Vasuki. And here there are Asuras also on the other side. So Muslims should learn about Hindu mythology. That is what he wanted. And also, for teaching them, there was, I mean, all the descriptions were given in Persian on this part, so that it would be easy for them to relate with these things. And also at the same time, with the help of the paintings also. So Mahabharata was translated, and it was also, I mean, picturized. Similarly, Ramayana was also translated. It was also picturized. Many of the, I mean, versions of Bhagavad Gita was translated. So he was trying to bring both of them together. And this is, of course, Krishna, from the pranks of Krishna, because, you know, Mathura was very close to this one. It was only 30-40 kilometers from Agra. So the people should know about Krishna also, Mathura also, and the lords of Mathura also. For that, I mean, he wanted to have this kind of painting also. This is the Rukmini Swayamvara of Krishna. So most of it, and this is, of course, the fight between Vishnu and Indra. Okay, so one can very, very well see that Krishna is here on his Vahana, and here Airavata is there. So this also, again, he wanted that Muslims should come to know. So that was, and here this we have that Mahishasura about Devi Mahatmyam. The whole thing was again translated into Persian, and then along with the pictographs of it. Here, Devi is sitting here, and we can see Brahma on this side, Vishnu on this side, And Shiva has come as Ardha Narishwara. So this portion is Shiva's portion and this is Parvati portion. So they took that kind of minute attention into Hindu mythology. And now the fight is going on. Mahishasura Nirna, Shavidatri, Varade Nama, Rupam Devi, Jayam Devi, Yesho Devi, Jishtisho. So many of the incidents, many of the mythological that was also translated into Persian. And then once he brought both the communities into one single platform, there the discussions were taking place. That was at Ibadat Khana. Now the question is, this is Fatehpur Sikri. So in Fatehpur Sikri, this area, this is Diwan-e-Aam. This is Akbar's bed chamber. And here there is a structure. It is a single pillared site. Most of the historians were identifying this structure as Ibadat Khana. That is the place where Akbar was having discussion with almost all the fathers. Some historian would say, no, it is not here. It was here, this structure. Some others would say, no, it was here in this particular area. And some others identified this place. And this is the Haramsara, Akbar's Jodhabai's Mahal or Haramsara, this portion. So absolutely, there is no question of having anything at this area. But this was an area where people could enter. Others also could enter. And in this one, Haramsara, nobody could go. But that scholar, that is Sayyid Ahmad Mararavi, he identified a place, a fall, a mount at this place. Here you can see there are near about 12 trees growing over this one. And this is the Jama Masjid area. Sheikh Salim Chishti's Makbara is here. Buland Darwaza is here. And Akbar used to go from the mosque. He used to come back to his Haramsara like this one. So this was the area which that scholar, that is Sayyid Ahmad Mararavi, had identified. And later on, Rizvi and Flynn also. But they had no support, no proof in support of it. So when I explored that area, the entire area of Fatehpur Sikri is almost 9 kilometers. We also came to the conclusion that this could be the possible area. Now, as an archaeologist, I mean, you had to excavate it and then you had to prove it also. How could we do that one? So that would be one question. And the second thing is that Akbar, I mean, when these Christian fathers had come, initially, Akbar offered them residence in one particular area, but that was near in, that was a kind of caravan sarai. So many people were there. So these people, they did not like it. Then they were shifted to another place. And then Akbar again shifted them to other place, a third place, because Akbar was having some doubt that some Muslim would kill these people, because you know the people, the whole people were against the fathers. So Akbar had a doubt that somebody would make an attempt on the life of these fathers. So at the same time, he wanted to have the discussions also with them. So he wanted to keep them somewhere very close to his bed chamber. Now, where is Akbar's bed chamber? Akbar's bed chamber is here. Obviously, nobody else can live in this particular area. But their residence should be outside the palace area, because Father Rudolf Akaweva, the second father, he wrote a book known as Mongolike Legationis Commentarius, in which he said it was outside the boundary wall, outside the boundary wall of the palace. So I followed this area because this is the boundary. I followed this area. And then he says, in order to make the meeting of fathers and this one, Akbar, a secret meeting, a secret door should be made. So I got that secret door also. And then there was a place, it was earlier it was used for making perfumes. He used the word itar khana or khushbu khana. Khushbu means perfume. So he says in his book, Mongolike Legationis Commentarius, that it was earlier used for making perfumes. Then Akbar removed all those items from there and it was converted into a small chapel. It was not a church, it was a small chapel for the residents and worship of this place. So how did we do all this thing? So that is what we are going to speak today. So we'll just take it up one by one. So most of the scholars, some of them identified this place also as Ibadat Khana. And some of the scholars, they would say it was this particular structure on the top of it. It was like this. So they would say that Akbar would be sitting in the center, a man representing Hinduism here, Christianity here, Islam here, and then Jainism here. And they will be having about discussions that Akbar would be turning to all those people. But when you go on top of it, it doesn't have enough space for all the participants to sit. Of course, Akbar has got the central portion, has got enough space, but not the other areas. So we discarded that one. And then, as I said once more, this is the mosque area, Jami Masjid area. And this is Diwan-e-Aam area. And this is most of the Akbar's bed chamber. And this is the Haram Sara. So we are identifying the site here with 12 trees growing over that one. So when I went there, I am standing here. I could see that mound here. It is on my right side. Many trees are growing over that one. Why I got assumption became confirmed is because when I saw the entire area, explored the entire area, here I could get a arch, small arch. There were two arches. One more arch is there, that is on this side. And then a third half broken arch was also there. So there are two, three arches. So that gave me the initial clue that this would be the place. And then there was a boundary wall. It is running like this. And it is this mound is enclosed by a boundary wall. So this gave me the initial clue. And then it became like this. And there was one more clue, that was this dome. This was a whitish dome earlier. So initially, this small arches, and of course that enclosure wall all around it, and this dome, that gave me the initial clue. And just see the place where I'm standing. I could feel that below this one, the step would be there. The step for getting into the top of it would be there. Now, that enclosure wall is coming like this one. And then whether it is taking a turn, I made an excavation here. So I could see that, I mean, it is taking a turn like this one. This is that mound. And now some of the trees, initially some of the trees we removed, the mound became like this. Now we are going to take up the first excavation of it. Just see, this is a small trench, 5x5. Up to my chest, it is filled with earth. And fortunately, I got one platform and just below another platform. So this is something. Now we just thought that we have to extend the excavation this way and this way and also this way and this way. So for that, I mean, you had to cut down these trees, this tree, this tree. All of them were removed and then cut down. So it became one, two, third platforms. Now you can see the boundary wall. One more. The boundary wall is already there. It is, and it was enclosing this one. And that arches are here. And the dome is just behind it. And it was, as I said, initially, this arches, the boundary wall, and this area also, that is this dome, that gave us the initial clue. And the importance of this top floor is, that this is having, you can see that there is an antechamber, another room is here just behind this one, and this is the door sill for that one. And now as an archaeologist, you have to remove this bark, this bark, this bark, all these barks. When we removed it, it became, I mean, when I, in the earlier photograph, I had shown you a place where I was standing. When I excavated that one, I got the, this is the step to go up to this one. So now what we had to do is we had to remove all those things, all these barks. It became like this. So you can see the arches 1, 2, and the third one is half broken. Just behind it, there is a dome also, an enclosure wall all around it. This is the step. This is the first platform. I have given an arbitrary number 3. This is the second platform, and this is the third platform. This means you have been able to get a structure, but you have not been able to prove this was Ibadat Khana. So for that, I mean, what proof you have to you have got to prove it, that this was the real Ibadat Khana. So for that, we got that painting of Akbar's time. This painting was done during the lifetime of Akbar. It was done in 1602. Akbar ruled from 1556 up to 1606. Almost for 50 years he ruled. And this painting was done under the supervision of Akbar. And this painting was done in 1602. So it is not a photograph. It is almost like a realistic painting of Akbar's time. So you can just compare that painting with this photograph now. So it is, again, just to sum up things, we saw it like that one. At that time, only this clue was, that is the arch clue was there, and also this boundary wall. Then the first excavation, we got first terrace and the second terrace. And then it was further enlarged. So 1, 2, 3. And then finally, this is the thing. And where is that painting now? Let us compare that painting. This is that painting. This painting is done during the lifetime of Akbar. And in this one, again, I have this painting also, I have given an arbitrary number. You can see the boundary wall. I have given number 1 to this one. This is my addition. And in that excavation, you had seen a step. That step is this one. Then 3 terraces. So this is the lowest terrace. I have given the number, this one, 3. So people representing various religion, they are sitting over here. So this, he is in white dress. So most probably he might be a Zoroastrian. In yellowish, this cloth, he might be a Hindu. And in green, he might be a Muslim. So they are occupying the first platform, the lowest platform, let us call it. And it is easy for us to identify the people who are occupying this, that is the second. You can just see that second platform. This is Abul Fazl. One can very easily identify him. This is Faizi. It was his brother, Abul Fazl and Faizi. This is Father Rudolf Akoeva, who had come from Italy. They came to Goa, and from Goa they came to Fatehpur Sikri. And this is Father Monserrat, who is a Spanish man. So these two fathers, and Abul Fazl and Faizi also, they are occupying the second platform. Obviously, nobody can occupy the highest platform. That is, only Akbar could occupy this third platform, that is the top platform. So you can see this platform here. This is being occupied by Akbar himself. And then he was having discussion with Christian fathers. And then, as I showed you here, just behind Akbar, you can see a door, which means there is an antechamber, so that one can go from here to the other part. So that door sill, I mean, where the door sill stood, that we got the stone also on which the door sill stood. So it is that doorway. And then the arches, which had given me the first clue, those arches were there. I mean, there are three arches. So one, two, three, and the third one is broken. And similarly, there was a dome also just behind it. It was not part of this structure, but it was just behind this one. So it is a perspective view. The discussions were used to take only during the night time. Sometimes there will be during the daytime also. But they wanted to show it was during the night time this particular discussion was going on. They have shown moon also here. So it was this painting which confirmed that this would be the most probable place of Ibadat Khana. Now let us compare this painting also with the site. So again, the site photographs, you have it here. This is the, those arches are there. And then you have the boundary wall. We have given them number one. And then this step, the first platform, the second platform, the third platform, and then the doorway. Just compare this one. You have that enclosure wall. This is the enclosure wall, the painting. The step, we excavated the step here. The first platform where people representing various religion, they are occupying this place. The second platform, you can very well see the second platform shared by Abul Fazl, Faizi, Rudolf, Father Montserrat. They are occupying the second platform. The third platform, that is this one by Akbar himself. The doorway, the door stone is there. The arches, you have the arches here. And the dome is here. And here it is given, on the top of it is here. This is a word, sentence from Abul Fazl's Akbarnama. Afraze Bood Padiri. Padiri means fathers, because in Urdu, Padiri and Persian also, Padiri means fathers. Afraze Bood Padiri Radilf. His name was Rudolf Akoveva. So that is why Radilf Dani Shirane Nasare, that is Christian intellectuals. Nasare, and they were having discussion at Ibadat Khana at this place. So that is also given here. So this gave me the conclusive proof that this was the area of Ibadat Khana. And then there are, of course, discussion and descriptions about the site of this one Ibadat Khana in Akbarnama, in Ayn-e Akbari, in Muntakhabut Tawarikh. Muntakhabut Tawarikh was written by a critic of Akbar. Akbarnama and Ayn-e Akbari was written by Abul Fazl and Faizi. So they have also given description of this place where actually it is located. And it is on the basis of this one, it was conclusively proved that this was the real place of Ibadat Khana. And to me, it looks almost like a small Buddhist stupa, because it is in three terraces. If you see some of the Shravasti stupas at Shravasti and also at Vikramshila, it looks like this one. How? Because you know, Buddhism was not very prevalent during the time of Akbar. And there were no Buddhists also. But at the same time, Jamshed? I think there is some problem. Hello? The meeting. Stop sharing on our Edgino. Hello. No. So this was, I mean, actually like this one, and now how this is a computer simulation of it. This could have been like this. It's a computer, again, a computer design simulation. And Akbar was a sun worshiper also. Hello. So Akbar was a sun worshiper also. So one can see here that Akbar. So here you can see the sun, and Akbar's name is written here, and all the zodiac signs were there, and the name of Akbar is also written here. And this was one of the letters written by the Christian father to Rome, in which they said that, I mean, earlier they had a lot of hope that Akbar would be converted, could be converted into Christianity. But now they say, because we just cannot understand this man, one day he is worshipping like that of a Hindu, second day like that of a Jain, third day like that of a Muslim, fourth day like that of a Christian. Perhaps he doesn't believe in any religion at all. That is what they wrote. And this is the last portion of the second portion of their letter. This is in Rome Museum. We got a copy of that one. And this is the people of Europe, they had heard about Akbar because he was one of the most the richest kings of those time, one of the most king, I mean, who had a lot of areas, a lot of this one, richest king of the time. Because at that time, the Suleiman Magnificent was there in Turkey. And in Spain, Philip II was there. Philip II was, again, a very important king. Queen Elizabeth was there in England. And then Safavid rulers were Shah Abbas II was in Persia. So if you compare Akbar among all these people, only Philip II had as big an empire as that of Akbar. But in the case of Philip II, he had inherited everything from his father Charles V. Whereas in the case of Akbar, he had actually acquired the entire area. He had won over the entire thing. When he was born, he was simply a refugee. And from that, he had started building up an entire empire. Now, just to say then, the kind of realistic realism had entered into Mughal painting. So this is a structure, it is known as Hiran Minar. It is in Fatehpur Sikri. Here you can see that the elephant tusks, they are embedded into this one. This is another, there is only one minar like this one, along with the elephant tusk embedded into this one. So you can see another Mughal painting of Fatehpur Sikri, where you can see this particular Hiran Minar also. And with the help of which you can identify this place as Fatehpur Sikri. Again, the same structure. Now you just see this Mughal painting. It's again done during the lifetime of Akbar. And the name of Fatehpur is given here also. And here you can see that the same minar is painted here also. Nowhere else you have this kind of minar in India or even in other Islamic countries also. So here, I mean, the name of Fatehpur is also written here. And it was after the conquest of Gujarat, Akbar came back to Fatehpur Sikri in the year 1573. And this is a celebration on that particular day, and all his sons, they came and they paid their respect to Akbar when he came back. So in order to show that this was in Fatehpur Sikri, they have shown this Hiran Minar. So with the help of this Hiran Minar, one can easily identify this as Fatehpur Sikri, and also with the inscription also. And now just compare it, this one with this one. And this is another fort, which is known as, of course, we all know it is Daulatabad Fort. And you can see a minar here. It's almost circular. And now Mughal painters have painted it like this. So there will be certain differences, of course. It should not be compared with a later lithograph. It should not be compared with a photograph also. Certain differences, of course, would be there. And then again, just compare both these things. This painting shows that it had two minarets. One is, of course, it's a black minaret, and there was a white marble minaret also. Now an enterprising archaeologist, they can go and they can identify the site, whether there was an actual two minarets or not. But it almost looks like that. And this is, as we all know, this is Sikandra, where Akbar is buried. Here also you can see this is a terraced structure. You won't, nowhere in Islamic architecture you find this kind of terrace structure. One first terrace, second terrace, third terrace, and the fourth terrace. Again, it looks like that of a Buddhist structure of Burma or even China or in some other place. And how Mughal painters have shown, and just look at this minarets also. For the first time, you find minarets in Mughal architecture like this one. This is made of fully of marble. Before this one, if you look at Humayun's tomb, Humayun's tomb was built before this one, and in which you have no minarets at all. After this one, the great minar of Qutub Minar, you don't find that is a minar, not a minaret. These are minarets, smaller versions of it. So this you find for the first time in Sikandra, and from there it has been taken to Taj Mahal also. So Taj Mahal is the culmination. And you can have a close-up view of the same thing, all the minarets, four minarets, and how Mughal painters during the time of Jahangir has done it. Just see. This is a Jahangiri painting. You can see Jahangir here. He has gone to the Makbara of Akbar in order to pay his respect. And here, all the minarets have been shown. So this Mughal painting is an important clue for us, sometimes to understand the place and sometimes to explore also and excavate also. So this was because this discovery was in the year 1984. So at that time it was published very well by Times of India. Mrs. Gandhi was alive at that time. She was very fond of this kind of things, and especially Ibadat Khana, because that is the nursery of Indian secularism. So she wrote on the file that it is a very important discovery. Please send the details. Again, and now when the fathers came, they gave so many books to Akbar, and especially the Bible. So this was a Bible which was gifted by the fathers to Akbar. This is another part of the same book, that is Bible. And now this father, the second father, Father Monser, he wrote a book in which they said that here you can see the common report of the king's extraordinary kindness towards the priest prevented their meeting him, and they hence began to plan to remove their quarters into a house which was actually built against the palace wall. So the new chapel should be against the palace wall. It cannot be within the palace, but it would be just outside the palace. So that by making a door through this wall, a secret means of meeting might be devised. Because when the people rebelled against Akbar, because of the assumption that Akbar would be converted into Christianity, Akbar still wanted to have discussion with those people. But at the same time, Akbar feared that somebody would make an attempt on the life of his fathers. So he wanted to keep them somewhere very close to his bedchamber by making a door through that one, a secret means of meeting might be devised. When they told this king of this plan and this purpose, he immediately ordered the ointments, perfumes, and very numerous jars of scented water to be conveyed out of that house into another. For the house which the priest wanted was used for manufacturing and storing ointments and perfumes. So that was a perfume house from where everything was removed and it was converted into a small chapel. So here it is given that because, you know, that the place which they wanted to have, it was a khushbu khana, they call it coxbin khana. So you have to have, first is it is against the palace wall, it should be closer to Akbar's bedchamber. Then there should be a doorway also, and then there should be, it was should be a perfume making place also. So these are some of the paintings they had gifted to Akbar. So as we know, from known to unknown. So from known, the point is Akbar's bedchamber. So it was outside the palace wall. So I followed this place and here I could get a door. And here there was a mount. I identified this as the first Christian chapel of North India. And then I started excavating it here. Is a close-up view of the doorway. And the excavation started here. I am standing here. Excavation is going on. It is in progress. So initially, these are the bark lines. When we excavated, we got one room and then another room. So I wrote to Archbishop of Agra, Dr. Cecil Deza. I told him just to come here and see the whole thing. He came. He saw the entire thing and then he did not approve of it. He said they have got certain records with them. In that record, it was having three rooms, whereas the one we got, that has only two rooms. So I told him that excavation is in progress. We are also hoping that we would be getting three rooms and we have excavation is halfway through. So then we continued our excavation. I'm standing here and people are working here on all the sites. So it was initially this one room and two rooms. And I was very sure that, you know, this would be divided. This is the wall of another room. So there will be one room, two rooms and three rooms as Archbishop has said. So then I further excavated it. It became like this one. One, two, then three. Okay, you have three rooms, so what? You have not been able to prove that this was Khushbu Khana. So what I did is, when I was excavating, here I felt that here I would be getting that kadai or the iron pan in which, I mean, they would be putting this flour so that it could be heated and then conveyed into perfumes, converted into perfumes. So when I excavated this portion, I could that here. I could get that kadai, that iron pan in which I mean, which was manufacturing this one of perfumes. And just below this one, there was a fireplace also so that they could do the heating work. So we saw it like this initially. And then it was excavated like this. Then it became like this. And now we have got two, three rooms also. And also you have that perfume making kadai here. And now you have to get, unless you cannot prove it as the place of Khushbu Khana or perfume making place, unless you get some kind of things associated with perfume making. One, of course, is this particular kadai. This iron kadai is here, which can be heated from down below, and flowers could be placed over this one and then heated. And this was that heating chamber. You can see a small arch, I mean, through which logs that can be placed and then it can be ignited. And even now, there is a place known as Kannauj, where they are making perfumes. They are the same kind of arches are there. It would be boiled inside and then it would be conveyed through this kind of hoods. There, instead of wood, they are using this kind of baked kandas. And then I compared it with a Persian, with a Murakai Gulshan painting of Jahangir's time, in which you can see this is perfume making. You can see the same kind of arches for feeding fire. It would be boiled inside. And then through this conduit, it would be conveyed into these jars. And below that, there will be water also, so that it could be cooled. And the perfume would be formed at this place. And now, what else you have? What more evidence you have? So when I was looking for that one, I got this perfume bottle. It's a glass bottle. It was in several pieces, and then we could put them together. So I just wanted to know whether it was exactly that same kind of perfume making, I mean, bottles of Jahangir's time. And for that, I got another Mughal painting. Here you can see the same kind of bottles are there. It is an 18th century photograph painting, and Hawala Yaini Itar Saz. They are known as Itar Saz. Ether perfume bottles. The same kind of bottles are there. Let us have a comparative study of this ether bottle and this perfume bottle here. And finally, he again says that Akbar, when it was converted into Christian chapel, Akbar had made certain repair work also. So what could be the kind of repair work Akbar would have carried out? Obviously, I came to the conclusion that most probably while it was, perfume making, so oil, many other things would have poured on the floor. So the floor would have been completely dirtied. So Akbar might have given a new coat of, new flooring for that Christian chapel. And just to make it sure, I made an excavation of this one. This portion. So here, this was the chapel flooring, and just below that, we could get the flooring of perfume house. So this was the perfume house flooring, and just over that, Akbar had laid this one, because Akbar had very specifically said that, this father had very specifically said that he had made certain repair work also. And then, of course, that father, they could not convert Akbar into Christianity. And they returned back to Goa. Akbar did not want them to go back, because when he wanted to have intellectual discussion with those people, and he was very much satisfied also, although he was not converted. But of course, there were of course compulsion for the fathers also. Now from Rome also, and also from Goa also, there were innumerable letters requesting them to come back. So finally, they said that I have got a number of letters from fathers from provincial, and I should go back. And Akbar relented. And then he said that I'll be sending an escort. They said, no, we don't need any escort. But Akbar said, you are under my security, and people are against you. They may kill you. And this is my duty. Even though you don't want a security, I'll be sending a security. And Akbar sent them a security. And there was no problem, because the security group was there. An army was there along with them. So there was no problem in Akbar's jurisdiction. But they came to Goa. Of course, Jesuit fathers at that time, in 16th century, Jesuit fathers, they were very adamant on so many things. So they had a fight within a place known as Kongol in Goa. They had a fight with the local people, and ultimately the local people, they killed these fathers, and especially Father Rudolf Acquaviva. And when they killed this man, the news of course went to Akbar, and Akbar was virtually in tears, and he said, "Alas, father, did I not tell you not to go away? But you would never listen to me." That was the comment of Akbar. And when I took over the charge, then I did this work when I was in Aligarh Muslim University. And because of these two work, that is the discovery of Ibadat Khana and the discovery of the chapel, I got a chance to work in Fatehpur. I was selected in Archaeological Survey of India. So my second posting was in Goa. So I thought that, I had my first meeting with the Christian fathers in Fatehpur Sikri. And let me see whether any of the mortal remains of these fathers are located anywhere in the churches of Goa. So in Goa, we have got near about almost 10 churches are there. And the most two important churches are, one is Bom Jesus, where we have the relics of Saint Xavier, the great Xavier, and his body is kept there even now, very miraculously. And the second church, I mean, that is Say Cathedral. Cathedral is, of course, the most important, but because of the body of Saint Francis Xavier is there, Bom Jesus become very important. So one day I was going through this one, the church of Say Cathedral. I was along with Father Titonia de Souza. He is an independent authority on Indo-Portuguese history. So while we were discussing about all these things and going through this antiquities there, in one of the chapels, I saw a casket like this one. So of course it was an ancient casket, it was an old one. So curiosity drew us towards this one, and we were looking for the martyrs of Congolin, because it was at the place known as Congolin they were martyred, they were killed by the local people, and they are well known as martyrs of Congolin. So I just saw the beauty of the martyrs of Congolin written here. You can just see the martyrs of Congolin written here. So that was a wonderful moment for me, because as I said, I had my first meeting with the fathers at Fatehpur Sikri, and the second meeting is almost like this one. These are the martyrs of Konkori. So that was an important discovery again, continuously almost 2,000 kilometers away from this place. And then I just wanted to be very clear whether the mortal remains of Father Rudolf Acquaviva is also interred in this one or not. So I looked at this portion, and here it is the name of Rudolf Acquaviva. Ossa Beauty Rudolf Acquaviva is very clearly written here. So it again conclusively proves that these are the remain, I mean the mortal remains of Father Rudolf Acquaviva. Often in archaeology we are not so much successful. Because in Fatehpur Sikri, we have been able to discover Ibadat Khana. Of course, it was earlier, this one identified at the site by Sayyid Ahmad Marariwi, Rizvi, and other people. But we could conclusively prove that was the real Ibadat Khana. And again, the church also. And then the mortal remains of those fathers here in this, say, Cathedral Church. And also, part of the remains are in Bom Jesus Church. In Bom Jesus Church, I mean, it is known to the people, whereas this one was not known, because in Bom Jesus there is a painting of the particular incident, and the bones have been kept there in the sacristy of the church. So it was a great moment for me in my life, because the discovery was, of course, very important, and at the same time, the discovery of the mortal remains of those fathers here, it has become, I mean, added much more things to the whole thing. And this is how I saw Fatehpur Sikri. But when I went through the records, I could get a lot of this one information that there was a bazaar of Akbar's time. And when we excavated, we got the entire bazaar of Akbar's time. There are 463 rooms like this one, in which precious stones and silken cloths were traded. And if bazaar was there, then Akbar's road also should be there. So when we excavated this portion, we could get the road of Akbar's time also. The width of this road is 18 meters and 60 centimeter. And 18 meters, 60 centimeter is the width of the modern four-lane roads also. All the four-lane roads would be 18 meters and 60 centimeter. So this way, we could prove that this is how, you know, if you have got certain Mughal painting, because when before that, I mean, we were not having enough painting. If you have, you have the paintings in Ajanta, you have paintings in some other places also. With the help of this painting, we would be able to identify some of the important historical places. Till this time, painting was not utilized as a proof for archaeological excavation. But now we have got a very good opportunity to use this painting also for identifying various places which is not very well known. So this way we could prove that this is one method of exploration and excavation and further identification. So I think I have taken enough of the time. Now, thank you all. Thank you very much for giving a very patient hearing. I think there are two questions. One first question is, which is the chapel where we could discover that casket? This is Say Cathedral. In Say Cathedral, I mean the huge church, because that is the most important church of this place, Goa. In Say Cathedral, there are many chapels also. So in one of the St. Anne's Chapel is there. St. Anne is the mother of Jesus Christ. In that St. Anne Chapel, I could get this casket and say that is in Say Cathedral. And some portion of the relics of some other people that is kept in Bom Jesus Church also. Bom Jesus is again another important because of the basilica, because of the mortal remains of the St. Xavier kept there. So these are the two churches. And another question is, what is the difference between minarets and minar? Minar, like Qutub Minar, that would be a single minaret and it would be a very huge structure. It is not necessary that it should be attached to any particular building. It could be sometimes part of a building, sometimes without any kind of attachment also. It would be almost sometimes, you know, like a victory tower also. But minarets would be either part of the, minarets mean that would be either part of the mosque or some maqbara or something like that. And that would be in pairs also. If there is one minaret on one side, there will be another one on the other side. And sometimes that would be in four. For example, in this one, Akbar's Sikandra, you have got four minarets are there. In Humayun tomb, there is no minaret at all. And then if you go to Taj Mahal, there will be again four minarets on four sides. So these are the difference between minarets and minars. I don't think there is any more questions. Now there is one more question about the Christian wives of Akbar. Actually, there is a many people thought Akbar had a Christian wife also, because Akbar's mother's name that was given as Hamida Banu Begum. So her name was, her title was Maryamuz, Akbar's wife's name was Maryamuz Zamani. Maryam means Mary. Zamani means Mary of the age. And Akbar's mother's name was Maryam Makani. And one, the Mary who dwells on a place which is equivalent to that of the great Mary, that is Jesus Mary. And the name of Mother Mary is taken several times in Quran. And also at the same time, the name of Isa or Jesus Christ is also several times mentioned in Quran. In more than 33 places, the name of Jesus Christ is mentioned. And sometimes he is mentioned as Ruhul Qudus, because he is born out of Immaculate Conception. So that is also given in Quran. But this is known as, his mother is known as Maryam Makani and wife is known as Maryam Uzzamani, but they were not Christians. So there was no Akbar, no Christian wife was there, but there is a belief that Akbar had Christian wives also. And the connection with, because one question is about that the three terrace structure. This kind of three terrace structures are there in Buddhism. Buddhism of from 9th century onwards. That is what I said. If you go to Shravasti, there are two structures known as Pakkikudi and Kachigudi. Both of them are this kind of terrace structures. And on the topmost part, Buddha would be there. Sometimes Buddha would be in Bhumi Sparsha Mudra. And sometimes he would be in Pravajana Mudra. On four sides, there will be four Buddhas. And that would be in four mudras of this one, Buddhism. So this kind of structures were there in Buddhism. And also in some places like Burma, we have this kind of things. So there is some kind of remote similarity, because at that time there was no Buddhism in India. So there is no possibility of having any direct Buddhist influence, but some kind of remote thing is there. Even in Babylonian culture, there were certain temples known as ziggurats. They were also a kind of terrace structures like this one. And in Mexico also, we have got that kind of terrace structure. There is no connection. But you know, it looks similarly, ziggurats. And in Hinduism also, there is some kind of temples like this one. They are known as eduks. In some part of the North India, that eduk structures are there. And on the top of it, there will be a Shivalinga. Only a Shivalinga would be there. But worshippers cannot go into terraces. This kind of terraced stupas are there in Kesari also, because in Kesari, I myself had excavated a stupa like this one. And in this place also, that is in Bihar also, there are many stupas like this one. So it looks almost like that one. Yes, then now there is one, this one, Mughal Ram Siya coin. It is not as, there is a coin issued by Akbar, because Akbar, not only coins, in the house of Maryam Makani in Fatehpur Sikri itself, Hanuman has been depicted. And also there are Rama and Sita is also there, Rama and Hanuman is also there. So Akbar was very close to all this thing, and he wanted to have more and more. And Tulasidas was, of course, he was living during that particular period of time. And Akbar had a lot of connections like this one. And he wanted to bring the entire community, Hindus, Muslims, Christians, all of them, into one single harmonious whole. That is what he actually tried for. But he was not very successful, because even that Deen-e-Ilahi, many of the Akbar's strong friends also did not contribute to that one. So that way he was only, as far as Deen-e-Ilahi was concerned, he was not very successful. Otherwise, he built a huge empire on his own. You will be finding very few people like Akbar that way. And put up a very good Mansabdari system also. And Todarmal was there. He was the great revenue officer. So many people were there to help him. But at the same time, he could not succeed in having a religion which is acceptable to all the people. No, Abdul Qadir Badayuni, he did not accept this one because he was against it. He was a staunch critic of Akbar. Only Abul Fazl was there, Faizi was there, Birbal was there, many few followers were there. And they were limited followers also. Abdul Qadir Badayuni, he wrote that book known as Muntakhabut Tawari, in which he has criticized Akbar like anything. This actually, this Hiran Minar, that was a kind of minarets. Is Minar itself is. Hiran Minar, of course, it was before Akbar had killed it because he used to go for hunting. So while coming back, there will be number of elephant tusks also would be there. So that elephant tusk was embedded into this one. So it was a kind of minar, which was, I mean, from where the measurement of the entire empire was taken. So it was a symbolic structure. And some people said that Akbar had an elephant known as Hiran, and it was because of that, I mean, this was used. And some others would say, no, it was during the time of Jahangir. Jahangir did not live there. Akbar himself left Fatehpur Sikri in 1585. He did not return to Fatehpur Sikri again. He made his capital Agra. So at that time, there was a zoo there which was full of deers. That is why this name has been given to this minar. So there are various interpretations for that. In Diwan-e Khas, there is a pillar beehive. Yes. Is it, I mean, it has some connection that in Diwan-e Khas, I mean, we have that one single pillar and that beehive structure also. It has no Buddhist connection, but it has some connection with this one, Gujarat. In Gujarat, if you go, in almost all the brackets would be like that. And Akbar conquered Gujarat in 1575. And after that, this particular thing, that is, I mean, this kind of structures, there are a number of structures, not only in Fatehpur Sikri, in Agra, if you go to Jahangiri Mahal, you will be again finding the same kind of brackets. So this was many people, many of the things were taken from either from Gujarat. Champaner was another very big center. And Jain monuments, you know, that had also. In Jain monuments, you will be having certain serpentine brackets also. So all these were taken from Bengal, from Punjab, and also from Gujarat. Many art, this one, things were taken and it was absorbed into Mughal architecture. So if you look at this Mughal architecture, it's not only arches, it's not only minarets, it's not only domes, but many features taken from regional vernacular architecture. Other scholars identified Ibadat Khana on the basis of the first identification was made by E.W. Smith. He was a great scholar. He wrote four volumes on Fatehpur Sikri. So he was the first emperor. And that was a very curious building also. So that is, most of the historians continued to believe him because he was a very one of the biggest historians of that time. And then when Percy Brown came, Percy Brown also said that is the Ibadat Khana, is that particular structure. Then there were some other scholars, H.R. Neville, and many others also, Keane, Neville, and all of those people, they also accepted it. But then later on, I mean, a lot of further research was made, and it was on the basis of that, that Sayyid Ahmad Mararavi, Rizvi, Flynn was an, I mean, both of them were Australian scholars who carried out a lot of research. And they had also come to the conclusion that that structure would be, that mound would be Ibadat Khana. But they were not archaeologists. So here, I mean, archaeologist, if he has got, I mean, he has to come into picture and he has to identify thing and then he has to prove it also. So the role of archaeology comes into that. No, this Panch Mahal, it is a five-story building. You have a similar three-story building in Kimlasa. Kimlasa is a fort in Madhya Pradesh. And there is another two-story building like this one in UP also. But Panch Mahal is a kind of Badgir. Badgir means a kind of wind tower. In Persia, it was a different type of wind tower, but in Fatehpur Sikri, it's a very hot area. And the wind tower, they used it as a wind tower. So if you stand there, then I mean, it is almost a kind of air-conditioned climate would be there because the lake was always on the southern side of it. From that, I mean, the wind was coming. So it was known, it is known in Persia, it is known as Badgir. Bad means Hawa Mahal. So it was a kind of open Hawa Mahal, but inside the Mughal Haramsara, there will be some closed wind towers also, like this. Hawa Mahal. These, I mean, most of the scholars who had identified this one, that is Sayyid Ahmadi Mararavi, identified it because a hall of discussion cannot be inside the fortification. And then they had gone through Muntakhabut Tawarikh also and also Akbarnama. So all of them says by the side of the Haramsara. So that means it is not inside Haramsara. That is what Akbarnama also say, that is by Muntakhabut Tawarikh also say. So all other identifications were inside the palace, but both of them said Muntakhabut Tawarikh also and this one Akbarnama also it says it was by the side of the palace. So that this is by the side of the palace, not inside the palace, just outside the palace area and just outside the mosque also. And Akbar, after sometimes for certain discussions, he would be after the Jumu'ah prayer, he would be coming to this place. After the Jumu'ah prayer, he would come and sit here. So that means, I mean, there is a Badshahi Darwaza also. It is just outside Badshahi Darwaza. That is why some of the people used to identify the, I mean, that is Sayyid Ahmad Mararavi identified this mount as the place of Ibadat Khana. I think almost all questions are over. So Akbar was not very conscious, but in Fatehpur Sikri, this red sandstone is easily available. So whatever material is easily available, that they made use of it. In Fatehpur Sikri also, in Delhi also, because the same material is available. Marble, you had to bring it all the way from Rajasthan. Although by that time, by 1570, Akbar had 1570, 1572, he had conquered almost all parts of Rajasthan and the Rajputs also. In 1568 itself, he had conquered Chittor, And then in 1570, Jaisalmer, Bikaner, all those, Ranthambore, all of them were conquered. But Akbar had no fascination for Mughal. The Mughal building, I mean, even that inside the Jama Masjid, there is only one structure, which is that is Selim Chishti's Maqbara, that is made of marble. But that is also not made during the time of Akbar. It was during the time of Jahangir, the encasing was given. During the period of Akbar, it was also made of sandstone. So Akbar did not have any particular, I mean, this one, any kind of liking or disliking for any kind of stone. But when he got this, since it was easily available, and the whole Fatehpur Sikri was built within 5 years. And similarly, Agra Fort also. So you don't have much of this one, marble monuments of Akbar's period in those monuments. It was only during the Shah Jahan's period, he destroyed some of the this buildings of Akbar, and then he made it into this one, the marble structures. I think all questions are over now.